My name is Dr. Lakshmi. Topic for today is malignant ovarian CA, diagnosis and principles of treatment. So coming to the diagnosis of malignant ovarian CA, first we'll start with investigations. So hematological, it is the full blood count, biochemical profile and serum tumor markers. Imaging wise, it is pelvic and abdominal ultrasound, chest x-ray. Other imaging modalities may be appropriate, such as IV urogram, CT or MRI of the abdomen and pelvis. Normally it is CT for the ovarian CA. Serum tumor markers being CA125, 80% of epithelial ovarian tumors, also increased in endometrial, pancreatic and breast cancer, and benign conditions such as endometriosis, inflammatory bowel disease and hepatitis. Valuable as an early marker for disease recurrence, treatment response and early treatment failure. CA19.9, CEA may be elevated in stage 3 disease. AFP and beta HCG measure if less than 40 years old to help rule out germ cell tumor. TVS is transvaginal ultrasound. It is important in evaluation of patients with a pelvic mass. Classic sonographic finding of malignancy is a complex cyst defined as containing both solid and cystic components, sometimes with septations and internal echogenicity. Risk of malignancy index, that is RMI, criteria being menopausal status, premenopausal or postmenopausal. The scoring system is 1 and 3 and the score is A. Ultrasonic features being multiloculated, solid areas, bilaterality, ascites and metastasis. If there is this feature, then it is 1, and if there is no feature, then it is 0. If it is more than one feature is there, then the count being 3. So 0, 1 or 3, the score is B. CA125, it is the absolute level, which is C. So to measure the risk of malignancy index, we have to multiply A into B into C. CT or MRI abdomen pelvis, helpful preoperatively to know if the disease is advanced, useful in assessment of retroperitoneal lymph node involvement. Coming to the staging of ovarian CA, stage 1, where the tumor is confined to ovaries, that is subdivided into 1A, 1B and 1C. 1A is tumor limited to one ovary, capsule intact, no tumor on ovarian surface, no malignant cells in the ascites or peritoneal washings. 1B is tumor limited to both the ovaries, so no tumor or ovarian surface. 1C is tumor limited to one or both with any of the following features. 1C, 1 is surgical spill. 1C2 is capture ruptured before surgery or tumor on ovarian surface. 1C3, malignant cells in the ascites or peritoneal washings. So this is the diagram of stage 1A, 1B and 1C. In 1A, only one ovary is involved, 1B, two ovaries are involved, 1C, two ovaries with surgical spill and other staging. Next, coming to stage 2, tumor involves one or both ovaries with pelvic extension, below the pelvic brim, or primary peritoneal cancer. 2A is extension or implants on uterus or fallopian tubes. 2B is extension to other pelvic intraperitoneal tissues. So this is the diagram of 2A and 2B. 3A, tumor involves one or both ovaries with cytologically or histologically confirmed spread to the peritoneum outside the pelvis and or metastasis to the retroperitoneal lymph node. So 3A, positive retroperitoneal lymph nodes or microscopic metastasis. 3A1, it is positive retroperitoneal lymph nodes only. 3A1 subdivision 1 is metastasis up to 10 mm in greatest dimension. 3A1 subdivision 2 is metastasis more than 10 mm in greatest dimension. 3A2 is microscopic extra pelvic, that is above the brim, peritoneal involvement plus or minus positive retroperitoneal lymph nodes. 3B, macroscopic extra pelvic peritoneal metastasis less than or equal to 2 cm plus or minus positive peritoneal lymph nodes, includes extension to capsule of liver or spleen. 3C is macroscopic extrapelvic peritoneal metastasis more than 2 cm plus or minus positive retroperitoneal lymph nodes, includes extension to capsule or liver. Staging of 3, this is the diagram which is shown. peritoneal metastasis of less than or more than 2 cm. Staging 4, distant metastasis excluding peritoneal metastasis. 4A is peripheral pleural effusion with positive cytology. 4B is extra-abdominal organs. Treatment. The aim of primary surgery is to confirm the diagnosis, stage the disease, remove all cancer or optimally cytoreduce or debulk the cancer. So these are the surgical options. Full staging laparotomy, laparotomy, hysterectomy, bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy, omentectomy, lymph node sampling, omentectomy, pelvic washing or ascites sampling. Debulking surgery being the current recommendation is to aim for minimum residual disease, leaving deposits with a maximum individual diameter of 1 cm. But nowadays, the debulking surgery being there should be no residual tissue left. That is what is recommended. Ovarian cancer or cases with high level of suspicion should be managed by a trained gynecologist. So whenever you are operating, it is better an oncologist is assigned. Classification of chemotherapy agents. Chemotherapy is also an option for ovarian cancer. Alkalizing agents, they impair cell function by forming covalent bonds with amino, carboxyl, sulfuryl and phosphate groups. Alkalizing agents are classified according to their chemical structures and mechanisms of covalent bonds, that is nitrogen mustards, nitrosurias and platinum complexes. Classification of chemotherapy, there are anti-metabolites also. They are divided as follows: folate analogs like methotrexate, purine or pyrimidine or adenosine analogs like mercaptopurine. Then there are many natural products also in which we can take taxanes, paclitaxel or docetaxel are semi-synthetic derivatives from ear plants. They cause microtubular assembly and stability which blocks the cell in mitosis. Anti-tumor antibiotics is doxorubicin, etoposide. What are the side effects of these taxanes? It is bone marrow suppression, cardiotoxicity, peripheral neuropathy, rash, hair loss, mucositis and myalgia. Carboplatin, bone marrow suppression, nausea and vomiting, peripheral neuropathy, ototoxicity. Cisplatin, renal damage, nausea, vomiting, peripheral neuropathy, bone marrow depression and ototoxicity. So these are all the side effects. Stage 1A, 1B or grade 1 or 2, they do not require adjuvant chemotherapy. However, they must have undergone appropriate surgical staging. Stage 1C or stage 1A or 1B with grade 3, they require adjuvant chemotherapy like paclitaxel and carboplatin is the combination used. Those allergic to paclitaxel, combination of carboplatin and docetaxel is a suitable alternative. Recurrence rate of ovarian cancer in patient completing 6 cycles was 24% lower than those receiving 3 cycles. However, the difference was not statistically significant. 6 cycles associated with more toxicity, that is neurotoxicity, anemia and granulocytopenia. Stage 2, 3 and 4 completely or optimally debulked. Intraoperative histology to confirm ovarian CA, surgery followed by chemo is preferred. Those who are not surgical candidates, neoadjuvant chemo should be considered. If advanced disease is discovered, maximal surgical effort to debulk all tumor deposits necessary. Those who undergo complete or optimal debulking surgery, stage 2, 3 and 4, surgery followed by chemo is preferred. Platinum sensitive recurrent disease is also there. That is those who are treatment free for more than 6 months after achieving complete response post first line treatment. That is combination therapy with carboplatin and liposomal doxorubicin, carboplatin with paclitaxel, carboplatin with gemcitabine. Then platinum resistant recurrent disease, those who are treatment free of less than 6 months. So this is the other drugs which are used: palliative surgery like colostomy, lysis of adhesions, management of small bowel obstruction. Tumors with BRCA1 and 2 mutation, olaparib is used. It is a newer drug with relapsed ovarian cancer with mutations in one of the two BRCA genes who have responded to platinum based chemotherapy. So what is the role of radiotherapy? Radiotherapy is used infrequently. It's not of much use. So in stage 3, a whole abdomen radiation therapy, that is WART, more than 2 cm residual, complication of what being diarrhea, nausea or vomiting. can also be used for brain and bone mets. So what is the follow-up? The ideal and most effective follow-up asymptomatic women who have completed primary debulking surgery and chemotherapy and have no clinical evidence of disease is unclear. Follow-up every 3 months in the first 2 years, and to reduce that to 6 monthly interval until 5 years have elapsed. So palliative care, it is the pain management in these malignancies, and there is treatment of nausea, vomiting and constipation, correction of anemia, psychological issues. Thank you.